Hey, B here, and welcome back to Environmental Science. I gotta admit, I'm a little intrigued by the Mesosaurus fossil mystery from the last lesson. Oh, hey, Mia versus me, the one and only. Now, about this mystery, picture it. It's the early 1900s, and thousands of fossils have been discovered since the first dinosaur bone in 1677. Two groups of Mesosaurus fossils, buried in nearly identical layers of rock, were discovered on two separate continents. Two other reptile species were also discovered with a similar pattern, as well as one plant species. Now, imagine you're a scientist in this time period and you're trying to make sense of it. What might your hypothesis be for how groups of fossils from the same species ended up on different continents? Geologists, write down your hypothesis as well. Maybe they swam? The Mesosaurus, maybe, although it would have been a very difficult journey. But could the other land reptiles have really swam across entire oceans? And what about the plant? To solve this mystery, we're going to travel through time to watch the process of scientific inquiry unfold. Who knows? It might just lead to an earth-shattering revelation about the structure of the entire geosphere. Ready, geologists? Let's get to digging. To start our journey, we're going all the way to 1912 to follow a scientist named Alfred Wegener. As it turns out, he was curious about the Mesosaurus fossils as well.
If I put this continent here and this one here, they fit almost perfectly, like a puzzle. And not only that, this model also provides a link between the separated fossils. Could this mean the continents today used to be one giant continent? What to name this supercontinent? How about Pangaea, after the Greek word for all the earth?
In 1915, Alfred Wegener published a paper that proposed his hypothesis of continental drift. Continents slowly move across Earth's surface. To support this bold idea, he pointed to several pieces of evidence. There were, of course, the mysteriously separated groups of species, such as the Mesosaurus. Additionally, he pointed to tropical plant fossils buried on the Arctic island of Svalbard. These fossils are now located at a latitude way too cold to support them. This suggested the island was once located at a warmer latitude instead. Finally, one of the most striking pieces of evidence was the existence of matching large-scale geological features on different continents, such as the Appalachian, Caledonian, and Lesser Atlas Mountains. The rock layers of these mountains fit together nearly perfectly, as if they'd been split apart by ancient forces. What do you think about this evidence, geologists? Unfortunately for Wegener, other scientists at the time weren't very receptive to his ideas. He simply couldn't explain how something as massive as a continent could move across the Earth's surface. However, the rumblings of change were on the horizon, all thanks to the relatively new and developing field of seismology. Seismology is the study of earthquakes and the vibrations of the Earth. Around the same time that Wegener proposed his hypothesis of continental drift, seismologists were discovering more about Earth's structure. They accomplished this using a tool called a seismograph, which measures the waves created by earthquake activity. By using a seismograph on the opposite side of the Earth from where an earthquake occurred, seismologists were able to measure the speed of the waves as they passed through the Earth's core. They noticed something peculiar. The speed of the waves increased or decreased at certain depths, suggesting layers with distinct properties. Over the next few decades, as seismologists learned more, they were able to identify the main layers of the Earth as we know them today. Do you know what they are, geologists? There's the crust, or surface of the Earth, the mantle, the outer core, and the inner core. They also discovered distinct layers of the mantle, such as the lithosphere, which is attached to the crust, and the asthenosphere, directly below it. These layers are important, so keep them in mind. With these developments, the stage was set for a striking new discovery in the 1960s, which would give rise to, arguably, the most important theory in all of geology. By the 1960s, a large network of seismographs spanned the globe, providing lots of data on Earth's geological activity. This data was a treasure trove for geologists who began to notice a pattern. Earthquakes and volcanic activity tended to occur along distinct belts or lines across the planet. When geologists traced these lines, they divided Earth's surface into massive jigsaw pieces. Now, let's think about volcanic activity for a second. Volcanoes mean lava. And geologists, do you know where lava comes from? It comes from magma, or molten rock, within the asthenosphere. However, across most of the planet, Earth's lithosphere prevents lava from escaping. So, if lava mainly appears along the lines of this map, what do you think is going on with the lithosphere in these locations? Pause and record your thoughts in your notes. Geologists concluded that there must be gaps in the lithosphere, creating these hotbeds of activity. As more evidence came to light, the theory of plate tectonics was born. This theory states that Earth's lithosphere is broken into large pieces called tectonic plates, numbering around 20 in total. These plates lie on top of the molten asthenosphere, where heat from the Earth's core keeps the plates in motion. Essentially, Earth's lithosphere really is like one giant jigsaw puzzle. And not only that, but it moves, with individual plates drifting about 2 to 15 centimeters per year. This might not seem like a lot, but let's think back to the Mesosaurus fossils again. Thanks to radiometric dating, geologists knew that these fossils were over 250 million years old. That's a lot of time for South America and Africa to slowly drift apart. All of a sudden, Wegener's continental drift hypothesis looked not only possible, but extremely likely. All the evidence we've gathered over time points to it being true. So, what do you think, geologists? Should we consider continental drift to be a scientific theory today? Why or why not? Pause the video and record your thoughts in your notes. While you might often hear the terms theory and hypothesis used interchangeably, remember they mean something very different in science. A scientific theory explains a natural phenomenon, is based on lots of evidence, and allows us to make predictions. A hypothesis is an educated guess based on observations. Both continental drift and plate tectonics are backed by lots of evidence and are important to the field of geology. However, unlike the theory of plate tectonics, continental drift does not explain how continents move or allow us to make predictions for the future. Therefore, continental drift by itself cannot be considered a true scientific theory. Instead, it's become an important part of the theory of plate tectonics, which geologists now use to predict how continents will move in the future. For example, geologists estimate that the continents will eventually migrate back together, but not for another 250 million years. So, given everything we've learned, would you like to make any adjustments to your hypothesis about how the Mesosaurus fossils ended up on different continents? Pause the video and record your thoughts in your notes. Based on all the evidence we've gathered, the two groups of Mesosaurus fossils were very likely the same population around 250 million years ago, before they were split apart by tectonic plate movement. That's quite the journey these fossils made! And speaking of journeys, let's retrace our steps one last time to see how we got here. In 1915, Alfred Wegener proposed his hypothesis of continental drift, that continents had drifted apart based on various fossil and geographical evidence. Around the same time, advancements in seismology allowed geologists to begin mapping out Earth's structure and layers. Then, in the 1960s, seismographs revealed patterns that mapped out divisions in Earth's lithosphere. This led to the theory of plate tectonics, which explained how the hypothesis of continental drift was possible in the first place. It's so cool to see different scientific ideas come together. Remember, no scientist works alone. We're always building off of the knowledge left behind by others and asking new questions, forging new frontiers. And in the spirit of discovery, I've got a question of my own. If tectonic plates can move, what does that mean for all of us living on them? How does their movement shape our world? We'll find out more on our next expedition, where we'll join Fiona on a trip across the globe. Until then, I'm Bea. And remember, sometimes small shifts can have big changes over time, so don't underestimate the impact you can have. Stay observant, keep asking questions, and I'll see you next time. Hey, hey.